Hey, good evening, everybody. Sorry for the late start. We were greeting some guests, and we're glad to have some guests with us. There are several guests in the room, and in just a moment, we're not going to embarrass you at all. We're all going to stand up, and when we all stand up, we'll meet one another. And if you're a guest, if you can come up here once we all stand up, you can fill out a visitor form. We've got a gift card to give you, but we're not going to point you out or embarrass you, but we're glad to have you. If you're joining us online, we're glad to have you. Welcome to True North. We have to get going really quick because we got a lot of things to do tonight, and we're going to have some fun. You ready to have some fun? And Julia's with us again. You leave next week? Okay, so Julia's with us for one more week. We're glad to have Julia here and a lot of other guests. If you could take a moment to silence your cell phones, that would be great to make sure that it's not going to be a major distraction. Let's go ahead and do that, and let's very quickly get ready to greet one another. Hey, everybody, we want you to, adults, want you to do the same thing. We're about to stand up for a four-minute party. If you're a guest and it's your first time here, just make your way up here. We'll let you fill out a visitor form. Everybody else, find somebody that you don't know. Let's all stand up and let's have a four-minute party. Let's go.
What's up? I mean, this is pretty cool of you, honestly, to tune in to True North tonight. I don't know what it is about tonight, but I just kind of like got a feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. You know, like I just really think tonight's gonna be a good night. But you also look fantastic, if I were to add anything onto that. Okay, bye.
Hey! Yay! Welcome back to True North. It's Wednesday.
Yeah, it is.
It is
6:33.
January 25th.
Christmas was a month ago today.
That's so sad.
Hey, guess what? Birthday is on Sunday, guys. Logan Bug's birthday, turning 19 years old. Woo! Okay, good night.
Bye.
Welcome to anybody who may be joining us online, which may just be my mom and dad and Blake's mom and dad, Larry, Rhonda. We're glad to have you all joining us. Anybody else joining online? We got a great night tonight. Dr. Beth Robinson will be with us here in just a minute. A lot of energy in the room. We have a baptism following tonight, so it's going to be a great night. We're glad you're with us wherever you're watching from. Enjoy True North. All right, very good. Hey, how many of you did, in fact, meet somebody you've never met before? Raise your hand. We have lots of guests in the room, and we want to make sure that they're all being welcomed. Okay, some people are getting older. It's time to celebrate our birthdays
in the borough.
Anybody got a birthday from the following days, January 22nd to the 28th? Come on up.
Yeah, Jensen.
Hype. What are the hype shirts for?
For the hype.
You all just made them just for here?
It's all about the hype.
I like that. How do we get hype shirts? You just made them for whoever wants them?
$15.
Oh, $15? Is it for a cause? Oh, man. It's $15 and we can be hype.
I'd rather just be hype for free.
Thank you. All right, we got one of the hype girls up here.
Yeah. Did y'all go to a press game last night?
I'm just finding out.
Jared,
so anybody can get a hype shirt for $15.
Does it have to be? What color is it?
That color, it's pink.
Oh.
It's bright pink.
Okay.
I should have told you it was Georgia red and gotten you a hype shirt. All right. Happy birthday. You guys got your Abraham Lincoln Band-Aid.
What did you say?
You also now have a chance to win some cabbage patch. I'm sorry, cabbage patch.
You can get sour cabbage
sour patch
kids.
Not cabbage patch.
Sour cabbage patch kids.
All right. Let's bring up Zeb. Come on up, Zeb. All right, you know how this works? But I'll say it for the benefit of those who may be new. The way we do this, Zeb is the worst charades player in the world. We're going to give him a word. You're going to try to guess the word. You got 30 seconds. You all put your head down and close your eyes so you all can't see it. Everybody else, if you want to play at home, don't look. Here's the word Zeb's going to try. Here's the word Zeb's going to try to do by playing charades. Here's the word. All right, there's the word. All right, we've seen the word now, and you have 30 seconds. You can look up, Jansen. You can look up. You have 30 seconds to try to guess this word, and go. Talk it out. You have 15 seconds. I know you can't hear them, but I'm telling you they're nowhere close.
You can do it. I promise.
You can do it.
Come on, Jansen.
Give him some charades.
Come on, Lexi.
Oh, we've added a timer.
Oh.
That's even gotten more upscale. I like that. You all did not get the word. Wait, don't leave. You didn't get the word. This was your word. It was your word. The word was charades.
Come back.
All right. Oh, we're going to sing.
Sorry,
we're
I'm out.
We're going to sing.
I'm all out.
What happened?
I'm all out. Oh, okay. I'm all out.
We're going to sing happy birthday to these folks. All you got to remember are three simple words, and those words are...
Or still cool. It goes like this.
Well, you're 1 year older than you used to be, and you're still cool. You've still got it. It's plain to see. You're still cool. Yeah, it's your birthday today. That's why we're here to say that you're still
Colin, Colin and Cooper bring up a good point.
What's that?
What happens when it's Zeb's birthday?
Oh, that's good. I'll figure that out.
We got to figure that out.
You'll do it?
I think we should have Jeremiah Fox do it.
I like that idea better.
Or Harding.
I like that idea even better. We're going to Winterfest.
Muted.
We're going to Winterfest, February 17th to the 19th.
We're going to Winterfest, February 17th through the 19th.
Our registration is full.
Yeah, yeah.
It's full, but we can still get some more spots. We just have to know soon. We can get you some more spots. We just need to know those very, very soon. If you plan on going, you need to let us know. We got to figure that out really quickly. We've got our hotel rooms booked.
Yep.
We have our buses booked. We're going to Gatlinburg, and we have something up here. Tell us what we got here, Blake.
All right, so we have got a form for you to take your schools that allow you to get out of school early or just to maybe let
it
them.
It may allow you.
It may allow you. You may still have to lose that day as an unexcused absence, but maybe this will give you an excused absence. It just lets you know, hey, here's Winterfest. Take it to your teacher, your administrator, whatever, and then you come up and get Skid's signature, autograph, whatever you want to call it, because
yeah,
it's not on here.
I forgot to sign these before we copied them all. And so my name is on there, but we may need to get parents. If you need to sign it, you can sign it by proxy, or I can sign it for you. But or you can print a letter off. Maybe, Vicky, by tomorrow we need to sign one and put a new PDF up online. So please make a note of that, that we'll sign one, and you can take care of that.
Otherwise, people can get really good at your signature over the next course of a couple of days.
That letter is for you to take to a teacher, principal, coach, whatever, and it gives you some sort of documentation that you are, in fact, asking to be released from school for that purpose. We have a special guest tonight we want to welcome before we go any further. Cameron Miller is here. Cameron, just stand up. Cameron's on the front row right here. Cameron is a admissions representative from your official title, again, was what? It was very fancy. Regional Admissions Director. That sounds very fancy. From Freed-Hardeman University, and if any of you have questions about, hey, I'd like some info from Freed-Hardeman University, especially if you're a sophomore, junior, or senior, you can see Cameron. We do have the baptism afterwards, but he'll be in here, or maybe he'll go down there with us, and you can talk to Cameron right up here. Again, let's give Cameron a NBYG welcome all the way from Henderson. Let's welcome him to Murfreesboro. where we have several students. We have several students there, so be sure and tell them all hello. Okay, Peyton, where's Peyton? Is Peyton in the room there? Peyton's right over there. Peyton, tomorrow, is that right? Any of the NBYG girls that want to meet Peyton at Panera Bread from 4 to 5? Did I get it right? Okay, do that. Okay, guys, we're going to give you another chance. We're giving you another chance. Here we go. It's time for Stand Up with Ryder and Tucker. You all should just assume that you're ready to go most weeks.
What?
But give us a joke. You got one for us?
Sure. All right.
What do you call an elephant that doesn't matter?
What do you call an elephant that doesn't matter, Ryder?
I know this.
What?
An irrelevant.
Oh, that's good.
All right. You know what?
I like it.
I'll give it to you.
That was not bad.
Due to recent weeks, that's a win. I think that's a win.
Here we go. So we're going to try another episode of...
Wait, what?
Now, you saw this. I showed it to you earlier.
Oh, yeah.
And you were like, wow. You actually knew its cultural relevance more than I did because you're more in tune.
Yeah. Or younger.
How many of you would try this? This looks fun.
And he won't let up now. 4 seconds left. And that team need this immediately. They've got to keep going.
Now watch Gary. Oh.
Tries to clear. He blocks it. Just has to hit the floor.
But the blue car makes a crucial mistake.
And it's almost there. Just to keep
the white car makes a crucial mistake.
He's like, uh-oh.
There you go.
This is Rocket League.
Had that video gone longer, that might have reached the camp Japanese game show level.
Maybe.
Y'all were very, very excited
about
that.
Maybe we find longer videos.
We're trying this again because it does get funnier to me every time. In case a question you all are asking, what makes DJ Mike laugh? What makes DJ Mike laugh? DJ Mike is back there in the back on the camera. DJ Mike, wave your hand for those that don't know who you are. And we just say, Mike, send us something that makes you laugh. Hey, can you count on one more than one hand the number of times you've seen him like really lose it? I think I can count on one hand the number of times, and I don't even know what they.
I know one.
I don't even
within
remember.
The last year.
Would I remember it?
No, you weren't in the room for it.
What was it?
It was a guys' retreat. The Corny Award that was won.
Oh, yeah,
retreat.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. That one was the hardest I've seen him laugh in a while. For those of you that don't know, ask me later or ask somebody else.
Yeah, I can think on one hand the number of times I've seen Mike really, really, really lose it. But anyway, this made Mike laugh. This made Mike laugh. Here we go. That was funny. That was funny. So far, Mike has not submitted a video that I think made me laugh the same way it must have made him laugh.
Right.
But this did remind us of one of my top five favorite videos on the internet. One of my top, I know you've seen it, but it's worth seeing again. That video reminded us of a classic.
The hurt doesn't show, but the pain just grows. So stranger to you and me.
That's one of my favorites of all time. Okay, now, last week, you remember Mike showed us a video. Do you remember what video made him laugh last week?
Yeah.
What was it?
It was the dog and the ribbon.
The dog and the ribbon.
Through the phone.
So don't stop me now. Don't stop me.
Cause I'm having a good time. Having a good time.
I'm short and star leaping through the sky.
All right, so Mike actually recreated that with his cat.
In ecstasy,
Mike
so
said, I'm going to try that with my cat. I'm impressed, Mike.
Don't stop me,
cause I'm having a good time, having a good time.
I'm a shooting star leaping through the sky like a tiger defying the laws of gravity. I'm a racing car passing by.
Mike, I just now realized watching that video, did you go and rip up the carpet at the Nashville airport? That carpet looked just like the Nashville airport. Did you see it?
Yeah, it's similar.
Was that your carpet? Oh, impressive.
Maybe he was in on the auction.
New segment. New segment. Here's our new segment. It's called... Sorry. That was what makes DJ Mike laugh. The new segment is called...
It doesn't make DJ Mike laugh.
Yeah. Bet you wish you had a handshake this cool. So we see handshakes from time to time, and I saw one the other night that I thought, wow. So let's bring up Jack and David. Jack, David, come on up. Come on up, guys. Let's get play the song again. Play the song again. Let's bring him up as we play that again. Bring him on up here, guys. Get on up here. Let's see it. We can roll that again or not. All right, come right over here. Come right
Jansen
over here.
Jansen, too, is that what you said?
Yeah, let's just demonstrate. Maybe you should stand up here so we can all see. We should see. I know I'm building this up, but I thought it was really cool. Let's see their incredible handshake.
But like, hey, make it like y'all Good. Walk up to each other. Don't just like, you know.
No. Back up further. You've not seen each other all day long.
Build the anticipation, people.
No, but here,
further up.
Blake, you go talk to Jack. I'm talking to David, and Blake's over there talking. No, we're talking here. And we're chatting in the hallway at school, and I'm like, all right, man, I'll catch you later. We'll see you later. Take care.
See you.
All right, bye. He leaves. Oh, now wait. And then Jack comes, there you go. It's not bad. That was not bad. I want to see it again. Let's go back. Let's try it again. Let's do it in slow motion. Do what? Oh, you do? Well, let's do this first. Do this again, then we'll see it. Let's do it again. Let's show us again one more time. Bet you wish you had a handshake this cool. Very nice. Now, Jansen, we're told. Wait, Jansen, maybe next week's. Okay. We'll do Jansen next week. Bet you had a hand. If you have a handshake that's really cool, try it, and then we'll call you up here. We'll see it in other episodes of Bet You Wish You Had a Handshake This Cool. Good job, guys. All right, we got time for one more thing here. One more thing. Let's see what we got. Is it in there? Oh, that's what. When I see the cool handshake, it makes me, I'm impressed. That's the new I'm impressed face. That's great. Clark, did your dad know we showed this? Yeah. Was he okay with it? Good. That is the greatest picture ever.
It would be bad if an elder was like, no, I didn't.
I know,
like it.
You're right. I'd be in trouble. Hey!
Up.
Hello.
Where'd you get that jacket?
Oh, I didn't put this up there. Sorry.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm off my game. A Wild Times with Cooper Grubbs.
I got it from a thrift store.
Where?
All Things Possible. It has a tag on it, and it's a ski resort pass from 1994.
No way.
I think it's either 94 or 98. I don't remember. It's an.
All right, we'll talk about
I probably have that jacket in my closet, actually. Go ahead.
That's cool.
It might have been that one.
So this one time when I was younger, my family went to Old Navy after church to do some clothes shopping, and we happened to see the Chapins there. Their family also went to Old Navy after church to do some clothes shopping. Our families were talking or whatever, and my dad was being a funny guy he is. He held up like a girl shirt, like maybe Hello Kitty or something to me. And he was like, wow, Coop, that'd fit you nice. And I was like, that's so embarrassing. So I just kind of put my head down the rest of the time. And then when our families were done talking to each other, we split ways, you know, and my head was still down. So I started walking away with the Chapins, which was even more embarrassing. So I was just really embarrassed that whole Old Navy trip. Say it with me. That's crazy.
Oh, wait a minute. We forgot the whole point. You can't leave without.
You have to say it.
Wild times.
Wild times.
That might be my favorite one so far.
We have something that is a really big deal. Progressively getting worse at that.
Yep.
Abby did a good job, though. Abby got it. Abby got it down. You want to demonstrate for us, Abby? You want to show us how to do it? All right, stand up, Abby. Abby's going to stand up. We're going to show Abby. We're going to show us here. Something is a really big deal. Very good. All right, good job, Abby. Abby's got it. Where's Jackie? Jackie, where are you? Jackie, you mind standing up? Jackie Hughes is going to be baptized after True North tonight, and we're all invited. After we're done, we will all head down there to do that. Okay, we're limited on time here, but we're going to do a game. Blake, we're going to pick a high school boy and a high school girl. Can you go get a couple of volunteers?
Yeah.
Somebody that maybe doesn't get a lot of time up here. High school boy and high school girl. Blake's going to pick them out.
All right, Miley. All right.
Okay. All right, you all ready to go?
Now, so they got to do something first.
They've got to go and find something. Tell them what they need to find.
All right, you need to find a willing adult to participate. A willing adult.
A female and a male.
Female and a male. They're all out there. Don't look at me.
Go quickly and get another adult. Let's go. Find a willing adult.
You don't act like it. You heard
okay,
me?
All right, that's fine. A willing
I'll tell
adult.
You later. Don't worry about it, Colin. Yeah. All right, give it up for the willing adults. And now we're going to paint them with eggs.
Okay, so you have now picked the person that you are going to be playing and competing against. Okay? This is the way this game works. The game is called... What Does That Say? What does that say? Now, all four of you watch carefully. Blake's going to keep time. We're going to show you one sample. You're going to get one sample. Then we're going to ask three of you to leave the room. And we're going to need... Sarah, would you help us out in a minute? You're going to take them to the workroom and go retrieve them one at a time. Make sure you all can't hear. It's not going to help the game if you all can hear what's happening. We're going to show you... Here's how this works. We're going to show you a series of words. This one doesn't count. This is just a sample, okay? Here's what we're going to show you. You'll see this particular set of words. And as you say it louder, out loud, and repeat it, it's going to reveal another phrase. So the words are lawn, sand, jealous. And when you say it faster and together and put emphasis on different words, you're going to say the answer. You got it? What's the answer?
Los Angeles.
Okay, the answer is Los Angeles. All right. Does everybody understand how to play?
Lawn, sand,
all right.
Jealous.
Now, we have eight words that each of you are going to try to get, and we're going to time you, okay?
Lozenges.
You'll get one pass, but if you pass... It's going to add 20 seconds to your time. So passing, you know, you may try to work it out for 20 seconds, or you may just say pass and risk it. You get one pass. After that, you just keep going, and if you get stuck, then the game's over, and you won't get to all eight of them. So there's eight clues per person, okay? Who would like to go first? All right, Daniel's been volunteered to go first. With the other three of you, would you please go into the workroom? Let's bring Daniel up here. Daniel, we're going to give you this microphone.
Daniel! Yeah!
You are going to either watch that screen or you can watch this one. Nobody else play along. Please don't whisper because he'll be able to hear it. The key is, though, you have to talk. You can't just try to figure it out in your head. You got to say it out loud. Now, here's a way to make the game more enjoyable for you. If you close your eyes, you will know what he's trying to say. It was really funny to watch Mike try to play this game. Blake was sitting away from the computer, and Mike cannot figure out what he's saying. Blake is cracking up because he can easily hear the answer. You've got to figure out what you're saying, and once you say it, give us the definitive answer. We move on to the next one. There are eight total after we put up the next word, okay? All right, you ready to go?
Eight total.
We're going to show you eight. This is a game that we call again. What does that say? All right, very good. All right, when I show the first word, you're going to guess. Everybody else, you can either watch or you can listen. Here we go. Here is your first one.
Owls of you. I'll love you. I love you.
Got it. Okay, go. Next.
My glitch horion. My gulch horion. My gulch horion. Oh, Michael Jordan.
Got it. Very good. Keep going. You're, all right. Three. Go, go, go.
Bucks stuffing me?
Nope. No. Definitely not. Keep going.
Buck stuffing he.
Hey, look at the one. Looking at that one might be helpful.
Is that helpful?
Buck stuffing he. Buck stuffing he. Oh, Bugs Stephanie?
Nope. Do you want to pass?
I do want to pass.
We're going to pass. That's going to add 20 seconds. We go to the next one.
Santiklaus. Santa Claus.
You got it. Very good.
Tub raid he punch.
Yeah, he does.
Tub raid he punch. He punch.
Just keep saying it.
Tub raid he punch. Tub raid he punch.
Don't say it out loud, but raise your hand if you got it. Okay, good.
No, you don't. Tub raid he
yes,
punch.
Yes, they do. Keep going.
Tub raid he hunch.
We can pass it again. Give him 20 more seconds on there. Okay, we're gonna. You wanna pass?
Yeah, let's go ahead.
We're gonna pass. All right, and let's keep going here.
These hound dove music. These hound dove music.
Yeah.
He hadn't said it yet.
No, I thought he did.
These hound dove music. The sound of music.
You got it. Very good. All right, we're going to keep going. Keep going. There's, I think, two more.
Thumb ill key wake Alexi.
You got it.
Yes, I do. Thumb ill key wake Alexi. Alexi.
We got to pass this one too.
Thumb ill key wake Alexi. How many of you guys know this one? No, you don't.
Yes. We're going to pass it. We got to go.
We got to go.
20 more seconds. This is the last one.
Tall mischief her son. Tall mischief her son.
This is my favorite one of all.
Tall mischief her son. A tall?
Say it fast.
Tall mischief her son.
There you go. Say it really fast.
Tall mischief her son.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And what is it?
Tall mischief son.
Oh my goodness.
We're going to add 20 more seconds. That one is?
Jefferson.
Thomas Jefferson. All right, we're going to add 20 more seconds.
No, it's not.
So let's stop. We're going to add, 60 seconds we added?
Okay.
Yeah, so 4 minutes.
I have a feeling you're not going to win. Would you go get Mr. Holt? Bring him out. All right? Come on up. A big hand for Daniel Jones, everybody. Let's go. All right, we're going to go quick. Bring him out. Go. Send him on in. Guys, we're going to get a guy winner. We'll see. What was the time?
Four minutes and 24 seconds. Yeah, got it. Good knocks.
All right. We'll see if they can do any better.
The Brady Bunch.
Did they send him to the workroom in the children's wing? All right, very good. Come on in. All right, Holt, here we go.
Oh, no.
I have a feeling you're going to be able to beat Daniel's time.
You got it, Hunter.
Okay. We're going to go back to the beginning. We've reset, guys. Is that right? We're going to show you the first one. You can pass any you want, but it's going to add 20 seconds to your time.
So I can pass like any number?
Yeah, you can pass it. Well, Daniel changed the rules because there was three he could not get. But hold the mic up close. Just keep saying it. Hold it up closer.
Yes,
just
please.
Keep saying it until you know the answer and then give us the answer. Okay, you ready? Here's your first one. Ready and go.
Mile of view.
Say it out loud. Keep talking. We got to hear you talk.
I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you.
Got it. Very good. You got it. Good, good, good. Go.
My glutch horde on.
Oh, my goodness.
My glutch horde on. My guts?
Nope.
My glutch horde on.
This is tougher than we thought. Pass. He's going to pass that one at 20 seconds.
Bugs Bunny. Bugs Bunny.
Oh, got it. Very good. All right, keep going. Go.
Santa Claus. Santa Claus.
You got it. Very good. You're on a roll. Go.
Tud, Raid, Heat, Punch.
This one's tough.
Pass.
We're going to pass it. All right, very good.
These Hound Dove Moose Sick. These Hound Dove Moose Sick.
You're on it.
These Hound Dove Moose Sick. That is not what's looking at, though.
Okay, you keep it up with the ones we're passing another one here. All right, here we go. Oh.
Thumb Out Key Wake Alexi. Oh, that sounds familiar. Thumb Out Key Wake Alexi. Something Alexi. Some
we're gonna pass that one too. Sure. Okay, all right, you got one more.
Tall Mischief Her Son.
This is by far my favorite one.
This is hard. Tall Mischief Her Son.
Fast. Say it real fast.
Tall Mischief Her Son.
All right, okay, we're gonna pass that one. That one was Thomas Jefferson. All right, would you go get any one of the ladies that wants to volunteer? Good job. Give them a hand. What is our time to beat?
3 minutes, 20 seconds.
Wait.
I added the time. He did it in 2 minutes, and then he got 1 minute and 20 seconds.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. That might have been a strategy to just keep passing. pass. Should have added 30 seconds. All right, we're going to see if one of the Smith girls
can do it.
Three minutes and 20 seconds. Daniel was 4:24. Is that what the bonus time added?
Yeah.
Okay, 4:24. All right, ladies, come on in. All right, it's time to play. What does that say? There you go. The guys have not done so well.
I'm a little nervous.
Well, you're just going to keep sounding it out. You get the game, right? You get to play it. There's 8 of them. You can pass as many as you want now because the guys kept having to pass. But it adds 20 seconds each time we pass.
Okay.
All right, you ready? Here we go. Surely she, who thinks she's going to do better? I got money on Peyton. Here we go. Ready and go.
You got to say it in the
mic.
Use
the mic and say it.
We want to hear
you gotta
say it.
Yeah, you
got to
say it.
Owls of view.
A lot of people are putting their hands down who had them raised a minute ago.
You want to pass it?
Yes.
Well, we're going to pass that one. Woo. Just say it.
My gulch hoard un.
That's right. You said it.
My gulch hoard in. Michael Jordan.
Oh, you got it right. Very good. Go.
Bugs Bunny.
Got it. Very good. We got two.
Santa Claus.
I can't imagine saying this while a skit is pointing at your face the whole time.
Santa Claus. Pass.
Okay, we're passing that one.
Tub Rad Heap Hunch. Tub Raid Heap Hunch.
We're going to pass. We're going to add 20 seconds.
These Hound Dove Moose Sick. The Sound of Music.
Oh, very good. Nice.
Thumb Ill Key Wake.
Yeah, you're good. That was
Thumb
good.
Thumb Ill Key Wake Owlixie. Thumb Ill Key Wake Owlixie. Thumb Ill Key Wake Alexi.
Yeah.
You're
thumb Owl Key Wake Wait, thumb ill, key wake, Alex he. Thumb ill, key wake, Alex he.
All right, we're going to pass it for time, so you got one more. This is our favorite one. Go.
Tall mischief, her son. 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 Tom Hilton, Tom.
I just want somebody to get this one right.
Tall mischief, her son. Tall mischief, her son. Tall mischief, her son.
All right, we're going to call time. It's Thomas Jefferson. All right, go get your sister. Go grab your sister. We got one more. We got one more. Scratch this off the list of games to ever play again. All right, we're going to bring one more out. We're going to bring Miley out and play one last round of...
Tall Mischief Person.
Yeah. I just want to... Okay. How many did she get right? Three? I think I got three.
Yeah.
Daniel got how many right? Do we know? Daniel got four right? All right. You have the chance to be the best at this game. Okay? All right, come stand right here. Now, look what happens. We're going to show you the word, sound it out until you hear what you are saying, and then give us the answer. We got to go really fast. Singers, would you all come on and get in your spot and get ready so that we can be ready to go? We're gonna shift gears pretty quick after this. Here you go. Here comes your very first one. We'll let them get out of the way. Here's your first one. The clock starts right now. Hold the mic up.
Yeah, say it into the mic.
I'm not saying anything.
Yes, you got to read it. You got to go. You got to read. That's part of the game.
Right now you're losing.
No, you say it.
I'm saying it.
Aisle.
Oh, that says aisle?
Yes, that says aisle. We're making up new games as we go. All right, aisle.
Aisle of you. Aisle of you. Aisle of you. I love you.
Okay, very good. Okay, we got one. Here we go.
My gulch, hold on. This is gulch, right?
Yeah, gulch.
Gulch. My gulch, hold on. My gulch, hold on. My gulch, hold on. My.
Whew.
My gulch, hold on. My gulch.
How many of you think you would be better at this game? Keep going. My gulch.
My gulch, hold on.
Hey, do this. Listen to Blake read those words.
My gulch, hold on. My gulch, hold on. Michael Jordan.
Michael Jordan.
Yeah, very good. Michael Jordan. We're just going to keep going now. We've already... You got this one. You got this one. Go.
Bunny?
Yeah, you said it.
Bugs Bunny.
You said it.
Bugs Bunny.
You got it. Very good. Woo! We're going to make it. We're going to survive, everybody.
Sand tackle off.
Talk loud. That's the
sand
whole point.
Sand tackle off. Santa Claus.
You got it. Nice. Oh, this one's tough. This one has stumped everybody.
Tub raid, heap punch. Tub raid, heap punch. Tub raid, heap punch.
All right, we're moving on.
Tub raid, heap punch.
Oh.
Let's go.
Dang it. These hounds dove move sick. These hounds dove move sick.
Yep, you got it.
These hounds dove move sick. These hounds dove move sick. These hounds dove.
That is the sound of music. We got two more. We survive two more. We get it.
Thumb will key wake owls licks he. Thumb ill key wake owls. I don't know.
Okay. All right. That's the Milky Way galaxy.
How?
Now, we got one more here. If you get this last one right, the room's going to go crazy. We'll survive this game. Here's your last one. Say it out. I keep saying it.
Tall mischief her son.
And right there. What are you saying?
Tall mischief her son.
And who is it?
It's a person.
It is a person.
Tall mischief her son.
Tall mischief her son.
Thomas Jefferson.
You got it right. Very good. We finally survived. Woo! Okay. All right. Wow. Well, the only thing that did is set us up for talking about anxiety later on. Nice job. Who says I could nail that game? I'm really curious. Who says, no, you're raising your hand. Who says,
yeah, well, it sounds easy.
So you think you can try it next week?
Yeah.
Cooper, you say you can do it? Next week, we will do like three or something. We'll let you try next week. All right, there you go. We are going to, we're going to move on completely. All right, there we go. Wow. Well, here's what we're going to do. We do have a special guest joining us all the way from, I believe she currently lives in Texas, even though she works for Colorado Christian University. But we are going to sing a few songs. Before we do that, guys, could you turn the lights out there in the back for us for just a second as we get ready to transition? We're going to sing a couple of songs. Let's get you all ready to go. I want to hear a reading from the Word of the Lord before we get started. Mandy, come up and use this mic. Guys, she's going to use this mic, and the Knox is going to say a prayer for us as we get ready to transition. Knox, come on up and get ready. HH1, guys. It's on.
Okay. 1 Peter 5:6-10 says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, with himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast."
Alex, use the same mic.
Okay. I'm going to pray if you guys will bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm just so thankful for this opportunity to be here, with so many Christ-minded peers, God. I pray that as we go into a time of worship, we'll open our hearts, we'll open our minds, and just totally embrace the words that we're singing, God, and we'll lift up those prayers to you, God. I pray that in every step that we take, we'll praise you, and every word that comes out of our mouth, God, is in praise to you, God. I pray that we are aware of your presence throughout our lives and throughout the rest of the night, God, and I pray that we'll just be able to lift up worship to you. I pray in your holy, beautiful name. Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand together. Before we actually sing, we're going to practice what we did the last couple of weeks. We've been talking about the concept of breath prayer. Breath prayer, breathing in as you read to yourself one part of a passage and then breathing out. We're going to try it in a couple of different ways tonight. We've read this passage the past couple of weeks. Let's read it out loud together from Psalm 94:19 first. Let's read it together. "In the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul." As we practice just the idea or the discipline of breath prayer on your own, you can read it as we breathe in. Let's breathe in and read the first part of that verse. And then just breathe out. If you remember last week, we went through each of these. We're not going to take time to do all of these again. But the idea of breathing in for one part and then breathing out. We're going to give you three opportunities as we pray three pretty popular breath prayers from Psalm 56 and verse 3. So I'm going to let you just do that on your own without explanation. You can read the screen, but let's just follow that prayer and breathe in. And then breathe out. From Proverbs 3 and verse 5, do it twice. Breathe in. And breathe out. And then in again. And then breathe out. And then you can do the next one on your own without any instructions from me. Just let that be that moment of stillness, because most of us, we've not had a chance to be still this week. You can look up those prayers on your own and just use that to kind of start your day. Let's sing a few songs together as we prepare our hearts to go further. Father God, just for today, help me walk your
Holy God.
some more time to sing next week. Next week, we've invited Sean and the praise team to come in and teach us two new songs that they're working on, one we've learned before and one that you've not heard yet that we're excited to teach you. So they'll be with us next week. We're going to try to catch back up, just running a little bit behind this evening, but we'll catch back up here. And we want to set a tone for a series that we have been doing called Hearing Voices, Learning to Hear God Through All the Other Noise. And there's a whole bunch of noise in the world. There may be noise even beside you right now. Like always, we want to ask if somebody beside you is distracting you, you can ignore them. It's going to be okay. Because we want to give a chance to focus. We showed a picture last week I'll come back to, but there's a song that when I was in 6th, 7th, 8th grade, I remember us singing this song. I asked some people if they'd heard it before, and a few people know it. How many of you in the back of the room know this song? How many of you have ever heard this song? There's a small handful of people. Michael, this used to be one of those, you know, campfire songs that we would sing on a retreat, that if we tried to sing it in the big church, you know, they'd be like, oh, we can't sing that in here. And this is a very, very, very simple song. And it's an echo song. So I'm going to teach it to you, and it's going to kind of prepare our hearts for our discussion on anxiety. Because in this song is that lyric, let me hear your still voice through all the other noise. It's very difficult to learn how to hear the voice of God. And people say, I don't know what that means. Like, is God going to talk to me in a burning bush? Is he going to talk to me in a, you know, through an angel? Is he going to talk? How does God talk to us? I asked this question recently to some guys. So I'm going to ask it to of you, Chandler. Chandler, if I tell you, if I say, hey, you're going to be hearing from me tomorrow, I will get in touch with you tomorrow, okay? Or we'll talk tomorrow, all right? There's probably, you know, Family Feud, five ways that I might reach out to you or that we might communicate. Not that I might reach out, but five ways that I might communicate. Can you think of, I mean, there's obviously 50 ways, you know, using communication methods throughout history. But can you give me five ways that I might communicate with you tomorrow? In person. Okay, in person. I might come by your house or come by your school, or I might meet you somewhere and we talk in person. That's obviously a big one and a number one answer. What's another way that I might get a message to you tomorrow? A cell phone, okay? With a cell phone, now I've got a couple of options even there. What are my options even if I use my phone to connect with you tomorrow? What might I do? I could call you, or I could message you through a variety of ways. It sends you a text message, or I could send you, I'm not going to send you a Snapchat, but somebody could. How else?
By pigeon.
Okay, all right, very good. Is that, you mean an app or an actual pigeon?
No, like a messenger.
Oh, okay. So I may actually send you a message. That's on the list of your top four? You're being very hopeful that I've got access to pigeons and say, go find Chandler. What else? How else might I communicate with you? I might email you, but you never check because no teen ever does. All right. Can you think of other ways that I might communicate with you?
Somebody else.
Yeah, very good. I might tell Knox, I want you to go and give this message to Chandler. I could send you a postcard or a letter, which most teens don't exchange anymore. But there's lots of ways I could communicate with you. And if you were only waiting by your phone and never went to your mailbox, you might miss a message. If you only waited by the mailbox and didn't go somewhere where I was going to meet you, you might miss that communication. There's multiple ways that I might communicate with you. And in this series, we're talking about a bunch of different ways that God may communicate. And we'll say more about that. But I want to teach you this song before we bring our guest on here in a minute. I'm guessing that she's already waiting for us online. But this song is an echo song. And we're going to stumble our way through it. And you just sing it and repeat the exact same thing I do. So it goes like this. Lord, my desire, Lord, my desire is to be like you. Very good. Say the things you say, do the things you do. Let me hear your still voice through all the other noise, so that I can be just what you want me to be. Whoa. I got low. I'll try to raise up. Let's try it again. Lord, my desire is to be like you. say the things you say, do the things you do. Let me hear your still voice through all the other noise, so that I can be just what you want me to be. All right, you guys did a great job with that. We used to sing that in 6th, 7th, 8th grade. That takes us back, right? Some of us used to sing that around the campfire. This is the picture we showed you last week from a vending machine. It said, the light inside has broken, but I still work. And that, I argued that was a metaphor for so many people that want to say, hey, I'm still here, even though it doesn't look like I am. The light's broken, but I still work. And then we showed you this comic strip of the turtle who sits there, Vern the turtle, who sits there thinking that he is forever alone when his friends have marched a valentine all the way around him, and most of us are just completely oblivious to what's been done for us. We showed all these different ways that we might be able to kind of cut through some of the noise. All those pictures for me are metaphors of just what many of you feel. Now, I've asked a friend to join us. Dr. Robinson is someone that I first heard at a youth conference years ago, and every year would go to her classes that we'd send off. They have keynote speakers and then classes for youth ministers to go to. And every year, for many years, she's taught a class, some sort of counseling class or some class on dealing with some aspect of mental health. And I've always gone and been really blessed. And I thought, you know what? Now that our tech team has done such a great job of making this possible, I thought it'd be great for her to come on and have a conversation, not just with teens, but also with parents. And I know of at least four or five families that said, we're going to be listening online. We can't be there tonight, but will it be online? And we're going to record this. It'll be there for her to use in her online teaching. So I think she's already on and ready to go. I want you to give an NBYG welcome to my friend, and hopefully now yours, Dr. Beth Robinson. Here's Beth. Hey, Beth.
Hey, good to be here. I'm going to tell you, David, you don't know this. I'm coming to you from the New Deal Church of Christ.
Oh, you are?
Yes.
Okay.
You probably don't know. New Deal is just north of Lubbock, and this is my house.
Nice.
But it's a remodeled church, so my office is actually in the back part of what used to be the auditorium. So I'm coming to you straight from the New Deal Church of Christ tonight.
Oh, that's awesome. So it's a remodeled church.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Very good. Now, Beth, our folks don't know you, and I've told them a little bit about you over the past couple of weeks, but I just want you to set up, give us some of your background, what you do, what was your degrees in, where'd you go to school, anything about yourself. We'll ask you some fun questions in a minute, but just tell us a little bit about your resume.
Okay. I'm a nerd. I'm a complete nerd.
Very good.
I have a master's in counseling, a doctorate in counseling. I teach counselors how to be counselors. I've written more than 15 books. I'm not sure what the number is now, but it gets boring after a while talking about that kind of stuff. My counseling practice for 31 years has been children and teens. And I work primarily with kids that have a lot of trauma. In addition to that, just in the last couple of years, I've started working with 18 to 25 year olds who are survivors of sex trafficking.
Wow.
So done this for a long time. Now, that's what the white hair says.
And you just retired recently from?
I retired from Lubbock Christian University after 28 years. I retired, and this is God speaking, if you want to know. Sometimes I don't hear real well. In December of 2021, I retired from Lubbock Christian University and thought I was done teaching completely and just was going to work with traumatized kids. And then Colorado Christian University reached out to me on LinkedIn and recruited me to go to work for them. I got hired on July the 18th, flew to Colorado July the 19th, and taught my first class on July the 20th. And the really cool thing about that is it has prepared me to do what we're doing tonight, because I teach online all the time. And so apparently God wants me doing more of this.
Okay. Now, do you know how long you've been teaching at NCYM, at the National Conference for Youth Ministry?
Garrett's 21 and probably started when he was about 3, so 18 years probably.
Okay. I've got notes over the years. If I go back through my notebooks, I can find lots and lots of notes, and I just kept coming back to those classes because there's so many great offerings at that conference, but you always said things that were very, very helpful for me to come back and work one-on-one with students and with parents. You've said things that have helped me. because I'm not a trained, you know, licensed therapist, never pretend to be, but you've taught a lot of classes on, you know, how to counsel without a degree and how to know when to refer. And here are some things that even a teen can do from peer to peer. So I've already told you that in the audience tonight, you've got 7th through 12th grade students that are all sitting up front. You can kind of see the room. And then we have quite a few parents in the back of the room, and college students, and there's some folks listening online. And folks will probably be watching this after the fact. Some of our parents will. And the reason I wanted you to come on, Beth, is because so many of these students that sit here, many of them think they're the only ones that deal with extreme levels of anxiety. What I didn't tell you, Beth, is that every week, the first Wednesday of every week, our students will fill out a small little card with their prayer request. We slide them underneath a door where some of our widows will pray throughout the entire hour that we're together for those things. And then they pray over those same requests all month until the next time. And when they bring those requests out and we look at them, the word anxiety shows up more than just about any other word. So I've asked you a couple of questions. We didn't plan this entire talk, but I want to just throw it to you to just talk about the, especially coming out of the pandemic, but I don't necessarily want to reference the pandemic. A lot of us are kind of, you know, we don't want to talk through that much anymore, but I want you to, as you've come out of it, you shared at a conference last year, the rise in anxiety among students. I'm going to give you a few moments just to talk about that from any angle that you want to as you deal with adolescents.
Okay, I think I do want to back us up before the pandemic, because by 2011, what research was telling us is that over 50% of incoming college students were reporting levels of anxiety and depression where they would be diagnosed with a mental health issue. That was prior to the pandemic. So you can imagine how high those numbers are now. The things that have spiked because of anxiety since then are things like self-harm and suicide. So I want to tell you, first of all, the majority of you are experiencing anxiety, and there are a lot of reasons you're experiencing anxiety, and most of those reasons probably aren't the kind of mental health things that everybody thinks they are. We know, for example, that there's a lot of anxiety related to how much time you're on technology. I know people are talking to you about that all the time, but probably they haven't said to you that being on particularly social media and gaming systems and how games are set up, they're set up to raise your anxiety because they're ongoing. And so your use of technology has a lot to do with feeling a lot of anxiety, and it's very difficult to step away from it enough to be able to know that it's made a difference. In fact, there are a lot of counselors today who will not even talk to you about going to see a medical doctor for medication until you have been off all electronics for 2 weeks.
You shared that at the conference last year, and I wrote that down, that a doctor will come in for your first appointment, and they say, I'm not even going to have another discussion until you are completely off all electronics for 2 weeks. Would you say more about that?
Well, and the reason for that is because we now know that the electronics work on parts of your brain that are related to you feeling anxiety. And so we know that it spikes your anxiety. And so until you're clean and sober from technology, we can't even assess what your levels of anxiety would be. So you've got to get clean and sober, completely off technology. Not that you have to stay off of it forever, but that lets us have a baseline of where you're functioning to decide if there are other factors contributing.
So I'm looking at the notes that I took last year, and you talked about this. You said that after 2 weeks being technology free, that a person's personality will shift and they'll be able to restabilize, and now we know where our normal level is because all of the other noise has kind of gone down, and we now know we're starting from here instead of trying to figure out where we're starting from. All that has to stabilize, right?
That's correct. We've got to get you completely off of that so we have an idea of what is impacting your personality. I can tell you, I work with kids who have a whole lot of trauma, and we see anxiety levels go up, but we also see irritability and anger go up. And a lot of times people don't realize that you being irritated by other people is a form of anxiety. And so we definitely need you off of that technology to be able to tell. And I'm going to say this to the adults, talking to you too, right at you. We've got to get the technology under control.
Okay, so say some more about just this. When you're dealing with students, they come in, somebody's, you know, says, I'm dealing with such high levels of anxiety. What are the things that you're going to do on the front end to talk with them? We'll talk about some specific practical, you know, grounding techniques here in just a minute, perhaps. But what are some things you're going to start, some questions you're going to ask? What are some things you're going to do with a student who comes in?
I'm going to sound a little bit more like a medical doctor. I'm going to want to know what kind of food you're eating. We now know, and there's a lot of research just in the last 3 or 4 years about how the types of foods that you eat impact your gut, and your gut has to do with your brain neurochemistry. We now know that. So if you're eating a lot of fast food or junk food, I'm going to say to you, try to eat real food. Let's get you on some real food to try to get you nutrients in your gut that will help with your anxiety. I'm going to ask how much activity you get. Now, not that you have to go out and, you know, do a huge workout or anything like that, but I'm going to want to see you out walking 20 to 30 minutes a day, preferably outside, because vitamin D out of the sun helps your anxiety as well. So if I can get you just to take your dog out for a walk while it's still sunny, that's going to make a huge difference. I'm going to talk to you about how much you sleep and when you sleep. One of the primary things that we know that's health related throughout the lifespan now, not just mental health related, is how much sleep you're getting. So I want you to be up every day at the same time, regardless of when you go to sleep. And that includes Saturday and Sunday. So those are the first things I want to see you do.
Trying to have a regular sleep pattern.
Yes.
What are the primary sources of anxiety for, again, I may be asking the question in the wrong way, so you can re-ask it or reframe it. What are the primary sources for anxiety among most students? And I think these would apply to college age and even to young adults and even to those of us who are older than that. What are some of the primary sources of anxiety?
Do you want me to talk about what people think make them anxious or what really does?
Sure, both.
That's two different things. Okay. Most people, because they're starting to feel anxious, they try to identify things in their environment, immediate environment. So it's the tests I've got to do. It's the schedule I'm keeping. It's the pressure I feel about a deadline. It's the pressure I feel to perform in sports. Those are the kinds of things that we want to believe cause anxiety. The reality is, though, probably underlying it more than anything else is technology use, lifestyle habits that we've already talked about, those health habits. And in addition to that, how much are you actually talking to people face to face? We have lost this ability to have conversations with each other, with teen to teen, teen to parent. When I started counseling, I always say I started in 1902 because I've been around so long. The number one predictor of a teenager not having mental health issues, behavioral issues, all those kinds of things was if your family ate dinner together every night. Okay, that's what we used to talk about. We want families to eat together. Well, what that used to mean is everybody came together and you had conversations. It was about the interpersonal interaction, not that you sat at the table. And the problem is now that even when we sit at the table, if we're doing that, which very few families do, we've all got a phone. And we know now, there's some research that shows that when you start college at age 18, you will have had as many conversations with people as previous generations had by age 6.
Wow. Say that one more time. I want everybody to hear that again. Say it again.
Okay. When you're 18 years old, this generation, you will have had as many conversations as previous generations had by age 6. And you have to have conversations to develop the social, emotional parts of your brain. And we now have a whole generation who have not done that. And it goes probably into folks who are now 25 to 30. And the way that we develop those social, emotional coping skills so that things don't make us anxious, the underlying elements have to do with all the brain development related to having conversations with people.
I've not heard you share that in one of the classes, and that's makes total sense, but it's totally fascinating. I want to, I may jump ahead just a little bit, but I want to share something that I think is relevant. You said last year, you were talking about parenting, and you said parenting is the biggest checkers game there is. So I want to speak to the parents for a minute. Teens, I want you to listen as well. But you're speaking to all the parents now. You said parenting is the biggest game of checkers there is. Can you expand on that a little bit?
Well, if you look at parenting as a long-term strategy, the key to great parenting is always thinking a move or two ahead of where your kid is. And so what that means is that we allow consequences to do our work instead of hurting our relationship with kids. So I always think about when I'm talking with parents in session, I say, okay, your kid could do this, this, or this. What's the consequence going to be? We need to know ahead of time what the consequence is going to be. And the consequence has to be meaningful to your kid. So I can't tell you, take their phone away, take their tablet away, take their car keys away, because that may not be what means the most to your kid. But parenting should not be stressful. It should be strategic, mm-hmm. where we're thinking ahead and saying, okay, this is coming up, this is coming up. How am I going to handle this when it happens? And have a plan in place. And again, let consequences do our work. And I'm going to throw another one in here too. We're big time into Save Our Planet. As parents, I want to urge you to save oxygen. If you were saying more than 3 to 5 sentences to your child about trying to redirect their behavior, I'm going to say to you, stop. Okay? In fact, you might ask your child, what do you think I'm going to say to you? And if they can tell you what you're going to say, it's not a matter of you teaching them, yelling at them, anything else. Now it's consequences. And you've got to give consequences time to work.
One of the things that you said last year, you talked about some very specific coping mechanisms. This is going to be for parents and teens. And I found this to go back to your conversation about, or back to your statement about having conversations. You said one reason that parents will often, not take away an electronic or not take away a device is because then they realize now I'm going to have to spend time with them. And so it's just easier for me to let the device take care of them. And so I don't want to take that away from them. And then you said this, which I wrote this down and thought is so great. You said sometimes in a coping mechanism, you gave things like, breathing exercises and other things that were important that we'll talk about, things that I've had to do in dealing with my own anxiety. But you said this, and I'm going to refresh your memory. You said bribery. And I was like, okay, that's an interesting coping mechanism. You said, they'll change their behavior when rewarded, which sometimes works better than punishment. So, for example, you said, go to bed early and journal about what you're feeling. I want you to go to bed and journal. And if you do, then I'm going to go and let you pick out something from the store that's worth $10. Do you remember saying that as a technique?
I don't remember specifically saying that, but I do talk a lot about the importance of bribery as a parenting strategy. We seem to have developed this mentality that we're not going to reward kids, we're going to punish them. And the truth is that if we went to work every day and we got punished every day and we didn't get a paycheck, we wouldn't go to work. And so I do believe that the research actually says positive rewards always work better than punishment or negative, taking away things. Positive always works better.
And here's what you said that I thought was so great. You said the main benefit of that, if you say, hey, I want you to go journal, write these things down what you're feeling, I want you to go to bed early, I'm going to take you to the store, let you pick something out worth $10. The main benefit was the social presence of the mom or the dad with the child, the teen, going to the store and doing something. This may work more for an 8 or 9 year old than it would for a teen. It would probably work for me, but if you said just the presence of mom and dad or mom or dad being with the child was going to be the benefit. Going to the store, getting something is great. But you mentioned that as one of the I just thought that stuck with me quite a bit. So let me.
David, let me hop in and say this too, since I've been parenting since 1902. I remember when I got the very first kids moved to my home because I've been a foster parent. And I can remember when the first teenagers moved in, I felt like a taxi cab service because I started with teens. And there's a reason, I'm going to tell those of you who have never done that, there's a reason God gives you your children as babies before they're teens, trust me on this because you love them a lot before you get them as snarky teens. But I remember, I felt like all I was doing was being a taxi service in the car. But that was so long ago. My kids didn't have technology in the car. The other thing that we did is we talked all the time in the car. When we were going from place to place, I had some of the best conversations with my kids in the car. And today, lots of times, kids get in the car, they plug in their headphones, and they're gone.
So now we've talked a lot to parents, and I want to speak to a student. A student who is finding themselves dealing with some a situation of anxiety, whether it is, you know, an actual panic attack, or it is just a moment where you're overwhelmed. Let's get really practical. We'll do this more next week. This is part of a two-part night that Beth's going to agree to join us. And then, you know, she even offered to do a third if we had some questions and you all wanted to write some questions down. And I would encourage any teen who wants to, you know, shoot me a text or anonymously write out something and say, I'd like to know this. Parents, if you want to write something down tonight or send a text, I'm not going to read names with them even if I see a name with it, but say, you know, help us know about this or tell me about this. I'd love to know something specific you wanted Dr. Robinson to talk about. But now let's just get really practical. We have a teen, a ninth grade boy or girl who is finding themselves in a situation where they just can't bring it together. Something has happened or they're, you know, dealing with something. As a parent, or if you're talking straight to the teen, give them five or six really practical, what you often call grounding techniques that are going to kind of bring them back to earth. I want you guys to listen very carefully because the other thing she shared has dealt with parents. You know, I've been pretty open and honest with you that in August of last year, I had a moment where I thought I was having a heart episode, called an ambulance and was taken to the hospital and thought, you know, something really bad is happening. After having multiple checks and a stress test and everything done, the doctor said, everything about your heart seems fine. You probably had a panic episode or a panic attack, which was a little embarrassing for me at 51 to say, you know, I don't even know what it was I was stressed about, but I've done some of these things that she's mentioned. I mean, I've literally had to sit there and do some of these things, and they've been very, very helpful. Give us a couple of grounding techniques for a teen. Now you're talking to the students in the room.
Okay, some of the things that you can do are you can use your five senses. So look around and name five things you see. Name four things you hear, three things you smell, you know, and just go through your senses, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and that'll be on a handout next week. So that's one of the most common grounding techniques. Music. Music works beautifully. The only problem is sometimes if you're feeling anxious, the music needs to be 60 to 80 beats per minute to help you calm down. So I understand there are apps that actually find that for you. So you need calming music, and it will help bring down your heart rate, and you will calm down.
Beth, you said music was helpful because it's got a beginning and an end. A song has a beginning and an end, whereas social media has no end.
I think that's some of the most fascinating new research that's out. They've actually researched specifically that, and what they have found is that music is much more calming than watching social media because a song has a beginning and an end. And in fact, when we used to listen to albums, that was probably more calming than our ability to keep music running on an endless loop that we have today. Because your brain wants to have a beginning and an end to something. It calms your brain down to know, this is the time we start, this is when we end. If you notice, when you come on Wednesday night, there's a time you expect for this event to end. We don't do well, even adults going to training, going to church, things like that, if we don't kind of know what to expect. Probably your church does an order of worship. I mean, we've gotten now where we publish that. We used to put the songs up on the board, you know, and that was the order of worship. But we have an order of worship, and part of that is people's anxiety about what's going to happen. Order of worship calms people down.
So you're talking about music and the 5, 3, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. What are a couple of other grounding techniques?
Okay, these are things you don't think about. Coloring. Throw a coloring book and pens. Pens seem to work better than crayons. throw those in a backpack, have them with you. Coloring works as well as meditation. They've done research on it. Playing, this is the one time technology helps. Playing Tetris or Candy Crush has a calming effect.
Okay, so
because it's like Candy Crush.
You mentioned this last year, which I found to be fascinating. You said that when kids came in, and y'all want to catch this, that are dealing with significant trauma and dealing with flashbacks or PTSD, that you said most people would say get rid of technology. It's only going to heighten that. But you said with one example, you've given two tonight, but you said one example, you mentioned Tetris, and the whole room in the conference laughed. And you said actual research shows, not any game, not any video Tetris. Game, but Tetris affects parts of the brain that make it impossible for a person to have a flashback episode while playing that game. Is that what you said?
Yes, that is correct. Tetris does that. And so, and Candy Crush is a lot like that, where you're still moving parts, but Tetris is what they did the research on. The research now is, I mean, it's old school. It's like 12 years old. They probably have some additional things. I mean, there are all kinds of games they now develop for you to work when you're experiencing anxiety, but Tetris you can get off of any app store and play it. And it absolutely works.
These are things that a student, you mentioned coloring. I'm just curious, how many of you, let's be honest, how many of you are colorers when it comes time to, I mean, we have coloring sheets at our house, Beth, and my wife put them out. And when teens are at our house, it is never fails to amaze me how many of them go. We have several things, works of art that many of you have done that are on our fridge that they have gone and colored because it is an amazing stress reducer, it appears.
It is. It is. And again, research, because I'm a nerd, I'm always quoting research. They've actually shown that coloring in a coloring book is as effective as a meditation session in calming you down.
Okay.
And I'll tell you one that I did today. I have a teenager I worked with right before I came home that has had some issues with cutting, eating issues. Her anxiety's high. And she came in with a broken arm. And I wasn't expecting that today. And so the activity I'd planned we couldn't do, and I had Legos to build an aquarium. And she actually, by the time that we worked on that today, she actually said, I feel less anxiety than I have felt in a month from putting together something with Legos.
And
she walked out.
And how old
I gave
is
her
she?
16.
Wow. Wow.
So... I'm also going to say, you know, we talk about the lost conversations for kids, but perhaps what we have in some of this brain development too is they lost the chance to do as many playful things as previous generations did when they were kids.
Wow. We've got about a couple of minutes. We're going to pick back up the conversation next week. I really do want parents and teens, if you say, here's something, like, I need to know this, like, I'm struggling with this, send whatever you want. We'll work that in. We'll kind of compile those and work that in. I hope that some of you take us up on that. You can email them, write them, or text them in. Beth, I want to give you a final word. We got a couple minutes left. We're going to pick the conversation back up next week. Tell us, give us a preview maybe. I'm putting you on the spot here, but give us a preview of what you might want to look at next week that might entice people to say, oh, I need to hear part two of this. What are some things that you feel like we need to get into next week?
Well, by next week, thanks to your church, I'm going to have prepared three different handouts that have different types of coping strategies. One set is breathing, one is mindfulness, one is grounding. So there'll be all different kinds of coping techniques that help with anxiety and depression. And I think that is huge for kids. I am willing to talk about any. I mean, if you get feedback this week that somebody says, we need to talk about cutting or suicide, or we need to talk about some other things that have been our ways of coping, I am more than willing to talk about those issues. And I think fundamentally... Go ahead, David. Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I'm just going to say, I think a whole lot of this is we have got to reengage with each other and have conversations. And maybe we have to learn to play cards together, learn to play board games together as families, as friends getting together, color together so that we have interactions that are playful, but also have conversation.
Yeah, that is so simple and so helpful. And I would love for somebody just to take her up on that and to try that this week. And some of you are already good at that. Beth, next week, last thing, I would like for you to speak to the teen who says, I'm at the lunch table or I'm in the hall at school. A friend of mine comes up to me. This is a student. And they see evidence of potential self-harm or just self-reporting of self-harm, or this is what I'm dealing with, this is what I'm doing. A teen then is petrified of, I don't know what to do. I'm 15 years old, I'm 13 years old, or I'm 18, and here's a friend of mine that is dealing with this. I've got to help fix it. I've got to solve their problem. I've got to, you know, what would you say to a student? We'll leave the answer for next week. What would you say to a student who says, I've got a friend that comes to me and I know they've got something going on bigger than what I can handle, but I don't want to betray my friend. I don't want to hurt my friend. I don't want to snitch on my friend. But what do I do? I'd love to hear you address that next week, because I think that's a question on the minds of a lot of students. And guys and girls, I'm really serious. I would love for you to send a text and say, would you have her talk about this? Parents, would you have her? I mean, like, send serious text, thoughtful text, because we want our conversation next week to be helpful. And if we need to, Beth has agreed to do a third week where we can just do question and answer, and we'll just read questions, and you just field those questions. Real quick, just so Beth can see, I think she can see the crowd. We're about to wrap up here and say a prayer. Raise your hand. I'm not going to have you share, but raise your hand if you've heard something tonight that you think, I needed to hear that. That's going to be helpful to me immediately. As a parent, I see lots of parents' hands up, lots of students' hands, and my hand is up, not just to show how to raise a hand, but I've heard some things that have been very, very helpful just in our ministry, as we do ministry together. Beth, thank you so much for coming. And how many kids have you fostered over the years?
15.
15.
Got a nice round number, 3 strings for basketball. Yes, sir.
There you go.
15.
And you were a basketball player, right? You played basketball in high school?
I did. Broke my back playing basketball, in fact.
Wow.
So,
wow.
And then I was a basketball coach for a little bit. I've been a sports psychologist. I can't decide what I'm going to do when I grow up, even yet.
There you go. Well, we're glad that you gave time to us tonight. Guys, go home and color. That may be helpful. Go home and breathe. Go home and sleep. And go home and sit down across from somebody that's a real human and have a conversation with them. Let's all thank Beth for being with us tonight, everybody. Beth, thank you so much. We'll see you next week.
Thanks.
We'll join Beth next week. Hey, we're going to say a prayer, and then we're going to go straight down to the baptism. Jackie, I think, may have already headed down that way. We're going to go down there. We'll surround her afterwards. Is there a friend of Jackie's in the room that would be willing, guy or girl, that would be willing to say a prayer over her and for her after the baptism? Is there somebody that would do that? Okay, all right. We're good. Lizzie's going to do that when we get down there, and that's going to be awesome. So we'll join anybody that wants to talk to us. You'll have to come down there to do it. If you have Winterfest questions, if you want to pick up a Winterfest letter, you can do that right here. Send us some things to ask Beth about next week. God, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for the opportunity to be here. We thank you for Dr. Robinson. And God, I'm thankful for whatever advice that maybe she shared that's going to be helpful to a parent or to a teen, to a guest, to a middle schooler or a high schooler, that's going to be helpful. And God, we're thankful now for the celebration we're about to witness with this baptism. We're thankful for Jackie, her family, and for the amazing role in the kingdom that she's going to play. And so, God, we go down to witness the celebration together with only an anticipation of what it looks like as you rejoice in heaven. God, we're thankful for our guests and new families that are here. And we pray that we can get them plugged into the NBYG so that they can experience the great kingdom work that is happening among us. And it's through your son's name that we pray. And we all say together, amen. God bless you guys. Let's head straight on down to the auditorium.